Oh, hi. Didn't see you there. Enjoying this wonderful pizza from Slice on Broadway, the people in Pittsburgh that provide good pizza, the podcasters. Hey guys, it's Mike Sorg at Sorgatron on the Twitter. It's the Awesomecast, awesomecast.net, our weekly dose of geekery and chicanery. With me, back on the couch, it's the Dutters, at KDutters on the Twitter. Katie Dudas, how you doing? Welcome, welcome back to the couch with the pizza.
The only reason I show up for the show.
There you go. Thank you, Slice on Broadway. We'll be talking about them a little bit. If you haven't checked it out, if you're not following me on Instagram, I had an encounter with the pizza and my dog Wicket that you can check out there as well. Also with us from the great Studio B, it's Chilla. John Chichilla joins us.
I join you every week from either Studio A or Studio B.
That's right.
You never know where I'm going to pop up. Maybe we can green screen me. I can come from like Niagara Falls one time.
Ooh, we were working on that a little bit, weren't we? But I worried. Well, one of my guests earlier on a serious interview show about healthy things was using the hats in Google Hangout.
Okay.
And started with the devil horns. So it'll be interesting later. Anyways, we're representing Pittsburgh technology in this podcast, the Awesome Cast, which we'll be doing big time here, at least with my awesome thing of the week. We'll be talking about Alphalab's Demoday. Somebody got an Apple Watch, and Googleio happened in last week. But you can go follow everything that we're doing over at awesomecast.net, including this. And I had a great talk with Robert Kocher over at Nebulous Cloud Audio Editing. And you can join us here live.awesomecast.net every Tuesday. We're trying to get started around 6:30 p.m. Eastern time. Again, live.awesomecast.net every Tuesday. And you can subscribe to us on the YouTubes, iTunes, Stitchers, Spreakers, iHeartRadios. A little iffy on the Stitcher these days. They have not been very kind to everybody. Feeds have been going down left and right. And if you've been missing our shows through that, please, I want to, and I'm a big Stitcher user myself, I would say start considering a new podcast catcher. Because that one is starting to really just miss stuff. And we've had shows that are like a week old that haven't updated, and we can't see why. And their settings don't work, and I'm hearing a lot of bad stuff about that. So just a little forewarning. I think I'll do that across the shows here tonight, if I recall. But anyways, we'd like to start off with our awesome things of the week. And Chilla, you got an Apple Watch. We got to talk about that.
It's funny because I got to give it to UPS. So I got a notification, I think it was Wednesday afternoon, that my watch had switched from order processing to shipping. And keeping in mind that it was leaving China at, I can't remember exactly what time, sometime after 5 p.m. on Wednesday, it actually arrived in Pittsburgh on Friday morning. So making its way through two cities in China to Anchorage, Alaska, and then sooner or later all the way to Pittsburgh, UPS actually gave the accurate delivery date of Friday by end of day. Apple actually stated that it would be here on Monday, June 1st, yesterday. So I did get it Friday. I got to spend the whole weekend with it. I have to say I'm rather impressed.
Okay.
With a lot of the capabilities and the how comfortable the watch is, as well as the percentage of battery left at the end of the day, to the point where I think I could get 2 days out of this device. I think last night when I went to bed, it was probably sitting around 63%. So I definitely could make it that next day. One of the things I'm interested in is maybe plugging it in when I'm in the shower and getting ready, and then going from there for my day to see where that ends me up. Can I make it just on that charge time alone? That being said, I think in the show notes, one of the things that I was talking about, what we talked about in a previous show, in Android Wear, is the lack of non-Google integration with Wear. So I don't know if you can bring up an image from the show notes, but I actually have a tweet that Douglas Gerda had tweeted. And you can see I have the options of reply and favorite, as well as obviously I can just dismiss the notification. This is one of the key features I was hoping to see in Wear, was the ability to take action on items. I know a lot of people mm-hmm. like Wear from the perspective of, you know, it gives me all my notifications. I can dismiss my notifications, and then I can also say, okay, you know who, and take a note and start and set an alarm and reminders, etc. This to me allows me to take action, or not just start a stopwatch or take a note or send a text message with my voice. This lets me take action on third-party applications like Twitter. Twitter is probably the primary one I've been playing around with. Instagram seems close behind in Twitter on the capabilities. Facebook is still more notification based than it is being able to react. Mm-hmm. I'm interested to see where they take this feature functionality. The setting up the health app and you know how active I want to be and how many calories I want to burn, and having it remind me to stand up every hour is not that important to me. I will say, and as I look at my watch, I've set up, I know a lot of different people talking about the different faces that you really have to play with Android Wear to get some of the more complex interaction in the face. I think Apple definitely did it right with the complications watch face. So I have the current date in the upper left-hand corner, the current time in the upper right-hand corner, my current physical location in the center with the current temperature and high and low for the day. And then down towards the bottom, I have my activity track and what time the next sunrise is or sunset, whatever's next. It'll give me the time for that. That being said, I really like all that feature functionality, especially in the morning, to be able to throw my watch on my wrist and see what the high and low for the day is going to be, as well as what it's currently doing out there. I purposefully did not load every application in the world down to my watch. I know a lot of people have their watches set to grab every app that can tie in. The camera app is pretty cool, where you can remote trigger the camera on your phone, and if your camera is not running or your phone is locked, it'll launch camera and allow you to take that remote picture. I'm going through some of the apps I have more towards the top. The Photos app, showing all of your favorite photos and syncing them over, is pretty nice. Google News seems a little iffy. I don't know if it's me or they need to fix something in their app. Flipboard's pretty nice to have if you're on a crowded bus or train and you just want to quickly flip through things. That's nice. But all in all, I have to say, I haven't got to play with it yet, but the Mac ID it's the unlock application. I'm excited to play with that, where my watch can actually unlock my Mac just by being in the vicinity. My watch can unlock my Mac just by being in the vicinity. So 3-4 days in, I'm color me impressed. And I did get the black with the black band. I have seen some people on the Facebooks and whatnot, you know, kind of knocking the 1 day battery life, saying, you know, my Pebble gets a week. I don't know if your Pebble, the one I had, gets a week for you.
Not a week. I think I have too much plugging. I have too much coming into it to get that week, I think.
So and that's where I wanted to comment the same thing, and I just didn't want to start to get into a huge debate of mm-hmm. Pebble versus whatever. That being said, I think the capability to respond to actionable items like the tweet and favoriting tweets that you're mentioning and all of that notifications, as well as selecting what notifications come over. I don't know if Pebble added that in a later revision. That was one of my things, was if you didn't want it to show up in the Pebble, you had to also make sure it didn't show up on your notification screen. So, and this, I can pick and choose what notifications come up on my phone and what notifications come up on the watch. The interesting thing is they try to make it extremely easy for the user, when it comes to notifications and app settings. Any of the apps that are watch enabled actually say mirror my iPhone settings. And there's a checkbox that's kind of customized, and you can alter what the options are on the watch versus what you have set on the phone. The other interesting thing is when the watch is on your wrist, the phone, from what I'm seeing, is if you have the notifications set for the watch, your phone doesn't ring in addition to your watch. It's one device giving you the notification. Your phone screen will actually stay dark. I'm very impressed. And as you can see, it's actually just as easy to me, to take a screen capture on your watch that automatically syncs into your photo album. That's awesome. You just hold down the one button and push in on the digital crown, and boom, you have a screen cap. So
it sounds like it mostly solves most of the problems I would have, because going from Google Glass to this, my biggest thing was Glass, I could respond, and of course you can't now because Twitter kind of went away. And it kind of like gives you that, okay, now I have to decide to take my phone out versus, there is a Twitter app on here. But not the notification I can respond to it. It's just a look-see, which is fine. It's a little bit of functionality. We just all want a little more, right?
Yeah.
It sounds like, and that's why I was really surprised when you said Android didn't do that. And I have a feeling.
So Android, it depends on the app.
Right.
So Twitter hasn't built Wear into the app. Now, I know that's one of the things that they talked about last week at I.O., was greater, deeper Wear integration for a lot of those third-party applications, and they threw up a screen with everybody's logo and app icon and whatnot. Right now, if you go into the Android App Store and look at, or Play Store, and look at what's out there from a Wear perspective, it's pretty limited. And even some of the responses to some of the applications that have added integration, where I think the application has room to make money, they're not even cashing in on those options. One of them was an RSS feed reader, that I thought was a pretty good idea for a Wear app. There's advertisements in it, and there's no way to pay to disable the advertisements.
Oh, that stinks.
So that's where and it's a free app, right? Mm-hmm. So you're thinking, oh, cool, I can use this, and then you're interrupted and you're in the middle of all of the RSS notifications with a bunch of adverts.
Right,
so
right.
I'm not saying that Android Wear isn't good, because I definitely think it's very well done. And the Google Cards series, like the concept of cards, to me makes a lot more sense as just picking up the device and how to swipe away a card, because I'm used to it, right? On an Android device, I'm used to it, even on the Google apps on the phone. They are definitely giving that consistent user experience. I just don't think the apps have enabled themselves from a Wear perspective just yet.
But still, it is surprising, because I would think, looking at the phone, or looking at the Apple one, I would think that's the not developed one. In other aspects, it is, because, I mean, they were kind of, look at all the watch faces we have for Android Wear that we've been around a year, right?
That's what's interesting, too. So as an Android Wear user, I don't know if you've used Wear, and coming from Pebble, the Pebble watch faces were front and center, right?
Right.
The Wear watch faces, you have to load an additional application, and you have to find an online library that has them. The Moto 360 came with, I think, 8 to 10 watch faces, and there's no way to add them within the Moto 360 app or the Android Wear app. You have to, like I said, download an additional application that you then go out to websites and collect your watch faces from.
Right, right. Well, we'll see. It'll be interesting to see the ecosystem between the two.
Right.
And what does develop.
I think even Pebble, I would say Pebble has wear beat from the watch face perspective, mm-hmm. because of the Pebble app, and there's a library of watch faces, and there's hundreds of them.
I want to touch briefly, because the news this week, they did they're finally shipping the Pebble Time. There's some reviews that have gone out. What have you read any of them? What are your impressions of the impressions, I guess, so far as one of the original Pebble people? Just real quick before we move on.
So, and I apologize because I have not read them. So okay. If you want to give me a synopsis, I will more than gladly respond.
Nothing much more than what we knew from the Kickstarter thing. A lot of the discussion in the review I read was very much like, this is not an Apple Watch. And it's not. It's not going to be. It's $200, you know.
It's not. Yeah, it's not meant to be. And guess what? Android Wear isn't an Apple Watch. Everybody has their pros and cons. And the one thing that Pebble definitely has on their side is they were first to market. The battery life, the price point. I'm interested to see, because I keep seeing the Moto 360, the price fall on that. So I'm interested in, are we getting another one soon? Did it all of a sudden become cheaper to make? Were sales that, I mean, I know a lot of people that's all they talk about is the Moto 360. Were sales better than anticipated? Mm-hmm. But I think Pebble got it right. And see, if you scroll back on that picture that was just up with the band right there, see that curve on the back mm-hmm. of the watch? That means it's going to conform a little better to your wrist.
Right.
That's something you don't get with Android Wear. And you quasi get with the Apple Watch. And I think that curve, that form fit, is what makes the difference in the watch and what makes it. I was talking, I think, a week or two ago about the Android, the Moto 360 is a bit uncomfortable. And it's because it lacks that curve. I think the Apple Watch is a little bit more comfortable based on the fact that I have the larger watch face, but it's still smaller than the Moto 360 mm-hmm. face, the round face on my wrist. So it doesn't reach over my wrist at all. It doesn't have that size to it. So I think Pebble's going to have a lot in its favor, not to mention it's cross-platform.
Awesome. All right. So he's your man to ask your Apple questions for. I think Time's going to be my next one. I really think so, because it fits. You know, I'm not ready to get 1.0 of Apple Watch, as nice as it is. I just really feel like I need to go ahead and wait on that one. But Time, in the meantime, yeah, it seems to add enough features that might be worth that cost and a little bit of upgrade from this thing. This thing has not been awesome. You know, don't get me wrong. And I love, like, I was like, this thing was like basically dead this morning. I threw it on the charger while I was in the shower and getting ready, and it lasted me through the rest of the day.
Does their new watch use a more universal charging mechanism, or is it still their proprietary weird?
I'm not sure. I haven't seen that
MagSafe type.
I haven't seen that side of it. It doesn't look like there's a MagSafe on the one side from the pictures I'm looking at. But there's a microphone on it. That enough, you know, gets me kind of interested. So
the induction charging of the Android Wear and the Apple Watch, I think, is fantastic. That is one thing I will say that I do like, is I can just set them down and they're off and charging.
Yeah, because so, that magnet thing has screwed me over a couple times on the original Pebble. So yeah, it's a problem. So let's touch on Katie. What is your awesome thing of the week?
I'm just like, hi. I'm actually going to watch fireworks from the roof of the Science Center on the 4th of July. It's pretty awesome. They're running a thing now. For $39, you get a popcorn and a drink, and you can watch on their lawn. But if you pay for $15 more on top of that $39, you can watch it from either the roof of the Science Center or on the Requiem, USS Requiem, out in the water.
Oh, nice.
And the cool thing about those two, when you upgrade, you get a free parking space with it.
That's really important on that.
Like, that's where, I mean, if not that it's not going to be amazing, the fire, I mean, just, I can't wait to see the view of these fireworks from this vantage point on top of the Science Center, but just the parking space alone, you can park anytime, 11 o'clock up to, like, I think 7 o'clock, plus you get admission to the Science Center. all day. Nice. So you can check it out, and they're going to have some fireworks exhibits there and some videos.
Okay.
So I'm really looking forward to it. I think it should be really cool.
You know, confession, I have never gone to see the fireworks downtown.
Ever?
I have seen the tops of them from my back porch and just put on the TV. The lady is going to San Francisco over the holiday, so I'll be here by my lonesome, so I might have to wander downtown and see what happens. So
it's definitely worth it.
Anyway, that's what the tea line's for, right?
Yep.
So
the one, how many people can fit on the roof?
I have no idea. She said, when I called, they said there were 10 spots left on the roof, and I took 6 before that. So there's at least 16 people up there. So I have no idea.
You're having a party up there.
Yeah, You know, I travel with a large entourage.
She's scalping tickets.
Yes. And it's funny because the thing I'm thinking is I have no idea who's doing the fireworks, whether it's going to be Zambelli or Pyrotechnico.
Mm-hmm.
And being from Newcastle, we know these things about fireworks, and we can tell the difference.
Which one's from Newcastle?
Both of them.
Both of them are Newcastle.
Fireworks like capital.
Fireworks capital, yeah. Of all things.
And chili, hot dog chili.
Hot dog chili.
And arson. What is their one spot?
And meth.
I do feel like
meth. No, I think like Westmoreland County, somewhere, Fayette County, somewhere's got to be this in meth.
Yeah, I don't know. I hear a lot of, but my work is in Westmoreland, and there's a lot of drug stuff going on that I get calls for. So, go check. So, CarnegieScienceCenter.org, and where they go under calendar and event details if you want information on that.
I can't wait. I can't wait to see the view. It's just going to be spectacular, I think, from up there. And like I said, getting to go to the Science Center during the day is a nice little bonus, too.
Let's see if I can get myself up in Mount Washington, perhaps.
Well, you know what time you have to get there? Like at 11 in the morning.
just public transportation, even?
People will be camping out all day long.
Just impossible. It's absolutely impossible, isn't it?
Just sit there all day. Take a little pee bag and...
You know what? I might have ended up... You know, now I think about it, I might have ended up on the North Shore during fireworks one time. Mm. Recent years-ish. But I don't know. We have so many fireworks. It could have just been a pirate scam.
The parking lot beyond the Sheridan, towards where you go down to the river to get on any of the big boats,
mm-hmm.
I always found that to be nice and non-crowded.
That could be it.
Mm-hmm. Over by where Icy Light Amphitheater used to be.
I miss you, Icy Light. Yeah. I miss you, Icy Light Amphitheater. Mm-hmm. So many good times at the Warped Tour there, the crowded Warped Tour. Anyways.
Mm-hmm. So if you know a great place to watch fireworks in downtown Pittsburgh, tweet us.
There you go. What are your 4th of July fireworks tips for downtown Pittsburgh?
Yes.
I'm just going to go wander. I'm probably just going to go wander. So
I think it's also, don't forget, you got a regatta.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the regatta's going on that weekend, so it'll be a lot of fun. Anything that floats, race, all that kind of stuff.
Yes.
Arts Fest next couple weeks, too. So.
Jeez.
Anyways, so I attended a little something on speaking of the North Shore, not too far from the Carnegie Science Center, down at Stage AE. There was the Alphalab Demoday. This is the second one I got to attend. And here's a little shot of what's going on. There's everybody at the end of the day representing the companies. A really good, and the packet's there if you want to look through it there, Katie. There you go. Nice packet with information about all the companies and what Innovation Works is doing and all the cool stuff they're doing in Pittsburgh. And then I don't know, some other company there. But no, it was great. So it's everybody's presentation. And I think I commented because Silicon Valley was just coming out, and it was the part where they were like doing the presentation at TechCrunch, and I'm like, this is what it's like. This is really what it's like. And like to the point where I felt like I heard a lot of the words they were making fun of, and I feel like everybody. I don't know if it's the kind of companies they had this year, but I felt like maybe just everybody is very self-aware because Silicon Valley has made fun of everybody in this space. But I didn't hear a lot of the buzzwordy kind of thing. I heard it from one company that was doing social media, like analytics and ad targeting, basically, which I still didn't understand what exactly they were doing differently than like everybody else, like Google. But still, some really cool stuff. There was only one robotics company, no drones, but I hear Identified Technology was one of them listed that's doing very well. We talked with Katie, actually talked with them last year. About the drones.
Mm-hmm.
Dick Zhang, is that his name?
Yes.
Sounds familiar. And Peacemaker was another one we talked to last year, and you said that there's a kiosk coming up in the Robinson Mall, right?
Mm-hmm. They even have signs up for it now. It's one of those kiosks that says this tenant retired. One of those cute sayings that they have on those, but it says Peacemaker's coming, which is very cool.
Which if you don't know what Peacemaker is, it's a toy. It's basically 3D printing toys, but it sounds like a gun company is coming, I feel like. And of course, No Wait, who's been doing nuts with raising funding left and right and like millions of dollars. I found the episode 23 or 28 of this show where we talked to them, and the CEO was down here in the studio, and now he's just all over the place, and I probably can't get a call out to him because he's that busy. But no, it's really cool to see that kind of stuff. Some companies that stuck out today. First of all, we talked to, I forget what the company was called when we had them on the show, but their app now is, they've kind of pivoted a little bit, and their app is now Stream Me, if this will work. Chilla, this thing is not working. This thing just went weird.
No.
Uh-oh. We're using a new thing to show off apps on here that Chilla has taught me.
I use it all the time.
I think I needed a refresh. Or something.
Yeah, if your maybe, device goes to sleep, you need to wake it up and give it a second.
I think I need to trust my computer again.
So
it's called Stream Me. You can find it in the App Store, and as soon as I can show you guys here, there we go. So you can find it in the App Store, and remember we were talking to them about they were doing like they're trying to use Bluetooth that you could go into a networking event. And really kind of like connect with people. They're actually using not location-based, more context and location-based. And they're going in, like, I just started an event here for podcast day. So this is like, if their example was if two concerts are happening across the street, like Lady Gaga and like a classical thing, those, if you use location-based, all those pictures would just kind of jumble together, right? But here, like, you know, I started my little event and you can pop in and drop your images on here. And it's kind of a Snapchat-y kind of thing. I think it does. I don't think my other picture went. Here we got one from the Stream Me team, and again, you just kind of slide through there, and there's everything from their event. There was a big one for Alphalab today, for instance. And again, it's very Snapchat-ish. You take a picture by tapping. You put some text in there. You can give it how many seconds that it's going to show up on screen. It's an interesting pivot. I think this is something definitely for concerts. I think it makes a lot of sense for events. If this is still going around PodCamp, I'd love to use it for PodCamp and see kind of if it catches on. But you know, I'm kind of back and forth with it a little bit. But yeah, there they are. There's the guys we had on the show here a bit ago. But really interesting to see how that's kind of changed over that cycle. Over just like what was it, 3 months ago we had them on, right? Mm-hmm. So that's Stream Me. You can check that out in the App Store. Another one I talked about before, Seekahoo. This was the one that's kind of lets contractors themselves. I'm actually in the market for a plumber perhaps here. And you actually go in it looks like Instagram for the most part. But the cool thing is they have before and after pictures of their work as contractors that just slides back and forth. And that's a really cool kind of interface. And it's not as costly to the contractors themselves. And I'm definitely more, you know, likely to use something like this rather than, you know, Angie's List or something. I always felt like that was a ripoff. And it sounds like it's a ripoff for both sides of things. So updating that, Travel Wits, we talked about the one that the idea was they want you to be able to, you have a budget and they'll find you the combination of plane, car rental, everything that you would want. They've actually updated that and opened a new beta for it because before it just found you the best flight, and now it's actually kind of putting more of those things together with their algorithm. So travelwits.com if you want to check that out. Robots, there was actually a company called, I'll get the company in a moment, but they were writing software basically for 3D cameras, and they say, well, 3D cameras are here. Like, and they pull it up, the Kinect has it, it's showing up on phone cameras, and they're trying to create software so robots can identify objects. One of the examples they gave was working with Amazon, because right now, and this is really cool, I've never seen this part before. Apparently the shelves actually come to the people to take the things off the shelves to the boxes. Because I think they used to have to go up and down like the aisles or something, right? So it comes to them, but it's only the person to identify the object on the shelf and put it in a box. So now they're trying to eliminate that person that's left over with the robot that will actually identify, and they won some prizes for that, and that was pretty interesting. Capson Robotics was the company there, and they actually had like a robot arm playing pool. Chilla, I think you'd be interested in this. How about Internet of Toys?
Internet of Toys.
This caught my... I was really worried when they started explaining this that this is going to be the talking Barbie that connected to the internet.
And that's exactly what I thought about.
But it actually is a little more low key than I expected. AE Dreams, I think, is the company, but they have this thing called Turtle Mail. And Turtle Mail is this little mailbox, and I guess it connects probably Bluetooth to your computer or something. And you see the kids playing with it there. And so what you do is you can take a toy, like a stuffed dog, they give an example. It's not even a dog, I think, in particular, but you register the toy. Let's say like DC can do this or other brands. So you register your Batman figure per se. And then you get messages from the little stuffed dog in the form of little bits and activities on papers that come from this mailbox.
So it spits out like ticker tape.
Yeah, like ticker tape. And then it's, you know, something that, you know, the company can have some kind of message, you know, that goes along with Superman or whatever the thing is, or Barbie or whatever it is. DC is the only one I remember seeing on the screen. But they had a good, like, six or eight companies already interested and involved in this thing. And it's interesting because, it's not like that creepy talking to you thing. And it's like, and it's little activities for them to do.
Can you interact back with it?
I think so, like to the point where like the kid actually has to sit down and kind of pull up the software to that point.
That's fine. I think that's okay. And that's the one thing I liked about that Barbie concept was that you could interact back. It wasn't like a one-way conversation or like Teddy Ruxpin or any of those types of toys. The Barbie had a way to then take input back, as long as you could do at least like some kind of web UI or launch an app to then interact back with the concept. I think it's a good thing.
So it's the toy will send you mail. So the example they gave is can send a quick love you from the toy. That's not creepy. You can subscribe to activities, right? So you buy the toy, you subscribe to the thing, and the company will give you more things to keep you involved. Give your toy a voice and talk to your characters. So, and that's interesting. That's really interesting. You can actually sign up to be a tester right now. So,
you watch Marvel get in on this just so they can reiterate the fact that they're going to have movies coming out. Mm-hmm. Don't forget to come see blah, 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 blah on whatever day.
It's bad enough they plaster it all over their comic books.
Yeah.
Like on the covers. Like, you look back on old comic books, you know, when it was in Marvel Unlimited, it's like, oh, hey, Iron Man 2 is coming out. And it's plastered on every comic book from that month. And you're just like, oh, jeez. And it's now like, it's now, and I'm seeing all these ads for Iron Man 2. But I guess that's how it works, right? Video games. There was somebody around video games. There was this company, Basin Labs, I think it was called. And if you go to Haxbox, haxbox.com, you can find out information about this. But basically, it's an interface that, you know, you can hook up to a GameCube, you can hook up the consoles, computer games, and it'll take the inputs from that. And this is for accessibility for the handicapped. And they showed a whole line of things. And actually, I pulled the pictures there because they actually had this set up. This is one of the only things set up for the general population that wasn't an investor of some sort to actually go and try out. And so here, they had a GameCube set up with Mario Kart, right? And you could, the one they showed, and I thought you'd be interested in this, and it looks like just a box. Here's a picture of the box. It's just a box. It looks like it's got like kind of serial PS2 ports in it, right? Uh-huh. But it connects to, there was this kind of old PC-style flight stick and it was mapped to the buttons and moving around in Mario Kart. But then beside it was a Leap Motion, and I had to hold my hand over the Leap Motion and open it, and that's how I threw turtle shells and stuff and items that I collected on Mario Kart. One, I just kind of want to play it this way. But also, they have other things, like other kind of joysticks, and I don't have a picture here, but like the tubes that if you're a quadriplegic, like you could use the tube, the blow tubes, to control things like computers and such. There was another one that was kind of like an arm move kind of thing. So all those kind of accessibility devices that are really kind of already there for other, you know, methods for the handicapped, they can be programmed and to play Mario Kart, to play video games in general.
And I think this is big, just getting into people with disabilities and giving them that ability to play games and to do those kinds of things. I think this is huge.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they're connected with a charity for accessibility in video games in general. That was really cool to see, and kind of the cool thing to see from the day. And it's involved video games. It's getting out there, and it's cool to see. It looks like they're going to have something out in the fall, according to the signs that they had up there. So and I really hope I get an opportunity to hopefully talk to these guys a little further around the video games. So Trust Lingerie was there. I don't know. It's not my bag. It's about bra technology. They're using the technology behind building bridges for bra technology.
Not being gentleman, you don't understand how difficult it is to find. Especially for, I'm not particularly an expert in this area, but large-breasted women having friends that are, and just what they go through and how uncomfortable they are, and just having to, and it's nice to hear that they're looking at different directions, since the bra has been the same for how many decades now.
Right,
basic idea.
And it makes sense, because generally the D cup has become more prominent, right? And just nobody has addressed it. And it seems to be like a bit of kind of just, you know, spreading out the effort, you know, around it. So I don't know the right way to put this, but the other cool story from this is they started a Kickstarter just to raise $25,000 to get production started. They ended up with like over $75,000.
That's great.
They did really great with it, and they got all over the place. They actually played a clip from the Today Show talking about it, with Kathy Lee and that other lady.
Hoda. There we go.
Hoda. I was like, I didn't know if that was right, and I didn't know. Yeah. Another one, PathView, PathVU. You can actually find the app currently in the Google App Store. They're actually already involved with Moves, if you're familiar with that app. I actually have it on my phone. It tracks not like my steps and where I go to take the steps. And so basically what they're doing is, like we've done and we have now with Google Maps, and you know, you can get around to everything with your phone. They want to do for walking and sidewalks, basically. So it's mapping sidewalks, you know, and they actually have a pretty deep mapping of Pittsburgh's information, and then they had that up there as well. Actually, here's a little bit of Pittsburgh, and they said this is real data of where to walk. You know, it'll actually, to the point where you know, it's at night and find a well-lit path around the other way around the block, you know, per se. But also, this is data that can go to the city to fix the sidewalks, which, you know, if they don't, that also leads to, you know, a financial burden on them as people, you know, sue for injury for not maintained sidewalks, etc. Kind of interesting. Like I said, it's already on the Google Play Store, so I'm hoping to load that up on the tablet to check that out. But it makes sense, especially as, and this is a perfect city to do it, since we are getting so data-minded. I mean, how many things can we log into and find out where the snow removal truck is, or when they're going to pave in the city? You know, this is just kind of another aspect that kind of works on top of that. So it's really cool. Anything else? There's so many things going on this one. Hackbox, Streamy. There was some a good brace. AbilityLife did a brace for Parkinson's patients to help with, you know, kind of the back problems that they would have around that. This one is a wearable technology for fatigue checking for truck drivers. Second year in a row, there was something for truck drivers. I hit up my good friend from high school to try to get his opinions on this as well. So a Bluetooth headset. I mean, it looks like a big headset. The company is Maven Machines. Just go to mavenmachines.com. And it will, again, checks for fatigue. It's connected by Bluetooth. The big trucking companies are behind this. Also, it checks your movements. And they showed a map that shows whenever the guy would do a mirror check. So you make sure they're doing all the safety precautions along the way as well.
And how's it monitoring for fatigue? Is it monitoring? Because this has been an ongoing issue for, and it doesn't just have to be truck drivers. It could be anyone that makes long distance commute or drives or whatnot. Is it monitoring the eye movement, or is it monitoring? Because that's one of the things I saw years ago was they were trying to use a small camera to monitor your eyelids and your blink frequency and things of that nature. I'm interested to know how they're, to your point where you can monitor the movement for a mirror check and whatnot.
Right.
How are they, is it heart rate or how are they actually?
I think it's generally the head movements. So okay. They're probably seeing the nodding off, you know, and like the motions that would, you know, resemble nodding off. It's also paired with Android devices. So, and I said, you know, these guys already have headsets and they're already doing phone calls and stuff on the headsets and doing everything else. And so they're just adding a functionality to the headset that's already there. And, sure. And again, you know, kind of giving that back end technology for the safety officers and the companies, that are already trying to monitor all these guys they have on the road as well. So it's just kind of another component to that. No, really cool. I think that's about all that caught my attention, but really good, a great variety, like I said. A good variety all around. It really kind of, like I said, I wasn't like sitting there, like there was a couple companies last year that I'm just like, I don't understand what these guys are doing. You know, it's something obscure. You know? We're manufacturing, et cetera, from so-and-so and this materials. It just sounds like space-agey to me, you know. And I don't know if they just had more kind of made sense consumer facing things this year, less apps, you know, going on, and like just more real stuff. Oh, there's another one. I thought you were checking these guys out before. I can't remember the company, but it was one of those that was tracking, much like when we had Emote on here a few months ago. They were tracking company. Loyalty, I guess, you know, through social media and such. I think you looked this company up before. I'm going to try to grab the name of it. Begins with an E.
And it was an emote? Because I like that.
It wasn't emote, but it's very similar. Not so much. It wasn't so much emotion based, but it was like how do you feel about your job, and everything. So. Oh, this is going to bug me now. Suitable is another one. I feel like Suitable. Katie, didn't we talk to one that was really like connecting high school, or I'm sorry, college kids like through careers?
Yeah, I can't remember what they were.
Do you think that was Suitable, perhaps?
It might have been, but I'm not sure. I can't remember who it was. I think you're thinking of Amplified.
Amplified, that is it.
Yeah.
You have the document in front of you.
I'm cheating.
Thank you. But again, you know, they went on ones where apparently they take the test and everything as they go throughout their day, and you can see a little bit of retention. And when you sit down with HR, it's not just how have you been, how's your productivity. It's actually like how do you feel about this and versus the work we're giving you, you know. And they can actually address those a little more proactively. So I think that's not being the person that's not in a corporate environment. I'm kind of the furthest from this, but that's important. You know, that's the kind of the reasons that I avoid that kind of environment, you know, and to see something like that happening is good. You know, I don't know. You're more in that environment there, Chilla.
Yeah. And the other thing, the brand loyalty, to me, would be a tough one to measure versus employee satisfaction. I've heard statistics like if you rate a product five out on a five star on a 5-star scale. If you rate a product 5 stars out of 5 stars, it means that you are 70% loyal to that brand. So there's a 30% chance if you gave them the highest rating possible that you're going to leave. So that being said, and I'm not a brand person, so I'm not familiar with how that all works and whatnot, but brand loyalty to me is a bizarre world that it's hard to calculate. And even when you're winning, you could potentially lose.
Exactly.
So it's not something I would necessarily want to be interested in, or I'm interested in it, but it's a hard thing to gauge. Mm-hmm. Versus the employee satisfaction and things of that nature. That I think, as long as the people aren't purposefully trying to game the system, it can definitely work out in an enterprise or even small companies. It's good for them. So, mm-hmm. I don't know.
All right. You can check that out. Look for the hashtag Demo Day and Alphalab on Twitter. And I think they were streaming it live. I'm taking a peek real quick to see if they maybe have that on. I don't see any indication. If you look on their site, alphalab.org, they may have a link there for a stream after the fact, I would hope. But go check that out. Follow that and follow the companies coming out of there. Keep an ear out. They do coffee clubs and such all the time. That's where I meet a lot of these companies. It's really cool to see, like, you know, we talked to those guys a couple months ago at Coffee Club, and seeing where they've gone since with these companies and seeing them really develop, you know. It's kind of like, to me, it's like watching those guys on the indies, duking it out, trying to learn their craft. And then you see them up on stage, up on the big stage, and doing really awesome. And you're like, that's our Pittsburgh guys. You know, the biggest thing, one of the guys from Ingersoll and Rooney, is where Chachi works, actually, was saying, hey, guys, Pittsburgh is cool. And the entrepreneurs are cool here. Making some direct comparisons with San Francisco. Said something about it was... it's like $90 per square foot for startup space in San Francisco. I might have that number right. Versus it's a lot cheaper here. And people are doing just as good at things around here as well. So other people doing really good things around here. You know, I was told, I should do this on the other show, but I was told there was somebody in San Antonio, Texas, helping out put up a wrestling ring, and says, yeah, man, slice on Broadway. In San Antonio, Texas, it's working. I don't know what business that's going to bring Slice, but there is an awareness out there. check out Slice on Broadway. They are supporting us here in Pittsburgh podcasting. Big friends of the show. We've had live shows there in the past. I'm hoping to maybe do one here soon again. I'm going to have to give Rico a call and see what's up. See if we can take over the top floor there again. A lot of fun. Katie's got it over there. Oh, she's digging in. She's digging in there.
Ah,
there it is. Uh-huh. Slice on Broadway. They give us a pepperoni pizza every week for our guests. Like Katie. Gets her coming in.
That's the only reason I'm
you
here.
You know, she might have wimped down, stayed at home with the cats. Maybe I'm thinking the Newcastle place, wasn't it? Mm-hmm. And just joined us. And I know Chilla, it aches him to decide to come to us from Studio B every other week.
Chilla, you know? Pizza.
Or maybe that's how he's maintaining his diet in that girlish figure of his. I don't know. I don't know the strategies there and what goes on in his mind, because I know he pigs out on the weekends. Holy crap.
You know, they should start. They don't have a remote or like FedEx type option, do they?
For Slice?
Yeah. That should be one of their things. You can get your Slice.
If you are not within the Pittsburgh region listening to this show and you want Slice on Broadway, you tweet them PGH_Slice and say, how much to FedEx me a slice from Broadway? There you go. And then there'll be an out. We're building on for them. Slice, take this idea, run with it. You can call it Slice from Broadway, a delivery service anywhere in the contiguous United States. Pack it up, FedEx it. There's food services. There's
other companies in Pittsburgh that do that with their food.
That's right. There's people that send cupcakes that way. right?
There's people that send sandwiches with coleslaw and French fries.
And what the big thing, the secret is you perfect the warming, the rewarming technique, right?
Mm-hmm.
You perfect that and say, no, don't just throw it in the microwave. It doesn't work for you. Put it in the oven. Put it at that 350 degrees. And yeah, it's going to take a little longer. Put it in for the extra 15 minutes for that one slice of pizza. It'll be worth it. Take the idea, Slice! We're going to be at Demo Day presenting this next year.
Yeah.
Alphalab applications, I believe this for the next cycle, are now open. So we are going to, on behalf of Slice on Broadway, fill out that application. Rico, you've been warned. So if you get a call from the fine people at Alphalab, this is why. There you go. SliceOnBroadway.com. Check them out on Facebook, Instagram. Check out check out why the dog loves Slice on Broadway as he joins me down here in the studio every week, and so much more. Okay, we got a little bit of time left. We gotta get to it because we do have a lot of stuff going on this evening. We got some people from the TV joining us for interviews for the Indie Mayhem show. So,
whoa.
That's right. Google I/O, let's touch on that real quick. What else came out? We mentioned a little bit about Google Wear. I think Chilla, well, first Chilla, because can I get on the stuff I'm excited about? Because how about a 360 degree GoPro rig? Just because. So
I think the studio needs two.
So it's yes. No, it's not that big down here. There's stuff down here you don't need to see in 3D, but still, you know, one of these days, right? So basically, this is open source. Anybody can make this, I guess, over the summer. They're going to release all the plans. And this is a way, basically, this is making content on YouTube for us to use Google Cardboard VR.
So I think this is huge. I think this is huge for your... real estate agents. I think this is huge for anyone that wants to do mapping of indoor facilities, whether it be a gaming cafe or Slice on Broadway or whatever. excuse me. I think this concept is going to take it to the next step, and not just from the VR, the Google VR platform, but just from the indoor map. I think from a lot of the mapping perspectives, I think this will aid in Google's run for internet supremacy and aid them in years to come. I don't see this concept going away. What I'd like to see from it is a way to do it a little cheaper than having to buy 16 GoPros.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's the barrier to entry.
That's a hell of a barrier, though. But still, that's not a big barrier. If you're a content producer, it's not a big barrier. If you're buying cameras, if you're buying rigs, like some people that I've been talking with lately, they're like, oh, can we use a Red camera for X, Y, and Z? I'm like, are you sure? You know? You know, and that's like, that. Those are the kind of people that are going to be doing things with this and pushing this envelope, just like they were making 1080 videos for YouTube before anybody could even watch that, right? And they're making 4K videos now before any of us can watch that, you know, and they're going to be doing this thing and having fun with it. I love it. I love that they're pushing something like this. And also, Cardboard, now available for the iPhone, officially. I need the modified one so I can play with it with my Nexus 7. And there's a few versions out there. So I'm waiting for that weekend where I have the time to start cutting up boxes and pick up the lenses, and we're going to make our cardboards. We should have a crafts weekend, Chilla.
Oh, darn it. I'm just recycling a whole bunch of boxes.
And then we need to find 16 people, too, that all have GoPros. So because while we're crafting the VR cardboard, we can actually do some video and actually build out a room.
There you go. That's awesome. Kitty, have you been watching this video stuff from IO?
Not as closely as Yins have been.
No.
Yep, Yins and you.
Yins.
No, I was excited about the GoPro cameras. I thought that was amazing.
Mm-hmm.
I'll be honest, and I'm sorry if I'm interjecting here, I have to say I couldn't have been more excited about any announcement recently than the photos announcement.
Yes, it's official.
Mm-hmm. It actually prevented me from purchasing an Office 365 license just for their unlimited OneDrive, because that's what I want primarily the OneDrive unlimited space for, was to back up photos and video. Mm-hmm. And there's actually a library uploader for your desktop now, which I provided a link in the doc, out on Android Central. It goes back to Google's site, and the Photos app was then later released for iOS as well. I think if you were a big Google Plus user with auto uploading your photos there, I think your photo library may have gotten moved on you. I think that happened to Derda. But for me, this was the big huge announcement, that bigger than any Android M announcement and whatnot. To me, this is a game changer for the way I use Google services.
This does, because I was considering, well, what do I do for photos for my iPhone and everything? And yeah, I've been on Plus for a while, and it's doing all the uploads, and I get all the auto awesomes. You know, I got some from Demo Day today of all the pictures I took of everybody up on stage, turned into an animated GIF. Every time, all the raw footage from all these shows goes up, usually via Google Drive, in some mm-hmm. fashion, and I get a highlight reel of this stuff every week. At this point, I've been thinking about posting, and they put music to it and everything. It's fantastic, and that they've made it free. And I was listening to Annie Yanako's podcast today, and his was like his thought was, if you're using a larger camera, it's limited to 16 megapixels. And yes, they're going to be reprocessing JPEGs, but if you're generally just taking pictures with your phone, you're going to be okay. Mm-hmm. And that's free storage, I'm good. So I'm going to take this uploader, I'm going to point it at my iPhoto library, and which is already, I have two of them, because I can't put the big one on my main drive, so it'll work with the photos library and iCloud anyways. Mm-hmm. Which, so there's a big barrier. Thanks a lot, Apple. I understand, this is the exact same reason why nobody went from Final Cut 7 to X. I get that. I was part of the process. Thankfully, I wasn't part of a company that was looking at that process. I probably would have gone insane too. But being a nimble independent producer like me, it was kind of easy for me to just jump on board. And this is, you know, there's no, you know, the what's the Apple photo one? The high end one. Like that.
Oh, Aperture.
Aperture. That Aperture kind of went away. And right. Now you just have this, you know. I'd be peeved too. It kills your workflow, and I understand they'll have a great Photos app like 3 years from now, but that doesn't help me right now.
I look at it as Google. I mean, it's Google Photos isn't like a huge part of the workflow from an editing perspective or anything like that. For me, it's this concept of I have unlimited backup and storage of all my pictures. Mm-hmm. I don't have a camera right now that's doing over 16 megapixel.
Like, this it's so amazing. So I took pictures during this show, and this is the first time I went to Photos, and this is the experience I have just on Google Plus, right? And I just have Google Plus set up to upload everything. Have mm-hmm. for a while, even does videos. Sometimes that gets a little scary, but already everything is up there. There's me playing with the dog. Oh, didn't go up there. What happened? There we go. There's all me and pizza and all the pictures I took with the dog, and there's everything, and there's my watch, and there's that message I found, and there's an auto awesome of everybody dancing on stage. Woo. and there's everything from today. I didn't have to think about it. Why does this work better than iCloud natively on my phone, which is bulky? If I went to iCloud.com, I'd be sitting here for a while.
So I have the same experience using the Photos app and mm-hmm. iCloud. I launch iPhoto or Photos every once in a while to make sure that it backs up all my iCloud stuff. That being said, obviously I have a limit on how much stuff I can store up on the cloud. So I have it where my machine pulls down the photos, and my last, 5,000 or some photos are up on iCloud. I'm not 100% certain on how much I would like to auto upload a lot of stuff, I look at it as I can now archive an unlimited amount mm-hmm. up on their service.
Mm-hmm. For now, at least.
For now, yeah. And that's where I hope a lot of these services don't say, oh, it's unlimited for free right now. And even Microsoft saying it's unlimited for $100 a year.
And the great thing is that searching that they're doing, because we saw bits of this already with Google Plus Photos, but I just typed in pizza. Seems to make sense for this show. And there's mm-hmm. all the pizza. There's Katie with pizza. There's, you know, I mean, it's amazing. It mistook this dog and blood comic book cover for pizza, apparently. There's more Katie with pizza.
I just need a whole imaginary blog with no strings attached, just me and pizza.
There you go.
Everywhere in the city.
DuttersEatsPizza.tumblr.com. Mm-hmm. There you go. It's a great service, and everybody should check it out. Android M announced the Google Now reading everything that you do is interesting.
I found it interesting too. So the Google Now reading everything that you do, and that whole tap concept, and then they also touched on the concept of their app permissions being just in time and not all in your face when you go to download the app.
Did it feel like a lot of? I thought this was surprising because there was a lot of Android catching up with iPhone.
That's the one thing that, for as much as you hear of all of the capabilities that Android has, mm-hmm. I think a lot of this is all about their play on security.
It was. I mean, the Android play I thought was a parody. It was so much like we're just saying all the things Apple did, and hey, we have Touch ID and all this stuff. And the Touch ID, I'll believe when I see it, because the implementation depends on your hardware manufacturers, and I don't trust the hardware manufacturers.
Samsung's gotten a lot better with their implementation.
Right, but they've been doing this for a while. It's not like this is the first iteration of Touch ID, this iPhone 5S. I have not had a problem with this since I got it almost 2 years ago. And it's taken it this long for Android to say, hey, we got this.
And they got Android Pay.
Right, and Android Pay. Android Pay, okay, sure. It felt like a lot of catch up, and I was really surprised. And other than the Google Now on tap, mm-hmm. I didn't see anything that made me want an Android device over an iPhone.
And on tap, and that whole Google Now can see everything. I was more interested, and I was hoping they would announce a lot more Wear type stuff.
Yeah, but it was all stuff they already talked about.
Yeah, I felt like a lot of their stuff was a lot of catch up and a lot of me too.
Yeah. So let's see what Apple does next week.
I think Apple's going to have an interesting time. I've heard some of their stuff may be a little behind schedule. So they may not get all the information out that they want to. That being said, I'll be interested to see what they come out with. I don't know if you want to go into a whole predictions and wish list, but I will say from the announcements that came out today with HomeKit, I can tell you I will be setting up zones and setting up rooms with HomeKit so I can use Siri to manipulate electricity around my house. That's
jeez. Sure. That sounds amazing.
I didn't add it to the show notes. There's a, I think on imore.com, they had a whole thing about, you know, Siri, turn on all lights downstairs or turn off the lamp in the bedroom.
I really wish I'd be surprised. And I still have the IBM HomeKit from my 1997 IBM Aptiva from Radio Shack. And I was really kind of hoping, like, yeah, you know, we're going to be even using that stuff too with your HomeKit. Sure. You know, then I could, you know, turn on two lights right off the bat, maybe. But no, I look to you for this. Cause every time I hear a home automation thing, we did this last week and it was a lot about the layer, with Android. Mm-hmm. but I was like, okay, what does this mean? And how long before you implement in your home, Chilla?
Well, that's what's interesting too, is that, and it's what I kind of put a complaint in the show notes about, you know, they're bragging about Jelly Bean and KitKat making up 76.6% of their install base. Mm-hmm. Keeping in mind that Lollipop only sits at 12.4%.
Yeah.
So what you're telling me is a year from now that Android M is going to be at 12%, which all this stuff's going to need more than likely.
Right.
Where I think the iOS adoption rate is what allows them to move fast. And if Apple's taught us anything in the last year, I mean, they announced HomeKit last year at WWDC,
mm-hmm.
and it's really not hitting the home until a year later. So how many years are we away before Android cracks this nut? I don't know. I hope it's a lot faster, and I hope they can move faster based on how long it's taken Apple to really move forward in this realm. I hope it's not another year, because I think competition is what's pushing all of the companies to the next level. And if it's taking them that long, we're probably a long ways off from seeing leaps and bounds in home automation technology, which is why for the last year I've put it kind of on the back burner, because I don't want to buy a bunch of equipment that doesn't integrate with either Android or iOS devices.
Right. All right. On that note, we had a lot of stories we did not get to, but we had a lot of big stuff. But WWDC coming up this week. I'll be watching in some shape or form. I think I'll try to duck some meetings, and we'll see what happens. I might be like, what did I miss at a certain point there on Monday? It has to be Mondays, man. Didn't they used to do Tuesdays all the time? That was perfect for us. But anyways,
it's June 9th.
Speaking of Alphalab, another Alphalab company, Robert Kocher from Nebulous. Go to nebulous.io. It's a cloud audio editor. I recommend you try it out. And they're looking for feedback, especially if you're a podcaster. But we had a good discussion with him on the Awesome Chat last week. We launched last Thursday. You can go to awesomecast.net. Go check out that talk and all the rest of the talks we have going on there. Keep an eye out. Create Festival's coming here around the Three Rivers Arts Festival in town. WordCamp Columbus. PodCamp Pittsburgh registration has been opened at podcamppittsburgh.com. Get that in. I already saw them rolling in a little bit, and already got some comments and feedback and all kinds of things. Please hit us up with all that kind of stuff, and we do read all your suggestions for that. Also, my talk with Crystal O'Connor from Libsyn last week. We talked about the Spotify deal. We talked about so much. There are so many podcasters there at the hardware store, including our friends at Epicast representing. It was a good long conversation. That video is up on podcamppittsburgh.com. Thank you to the hardware store for doing audio for the night. They mic'd us up and everything, and it was real, real cool. And we took some video, and then I ran out of tape, and Missy filmed the rest of it on her iPhone. And it looks pretty good. It looks pretty all right. So go check that out, podcamppittsburgh.com. And that's all I have coming up. I'm sure we'll get some more other.
You can. There's an event on July 27th that you can get in line for right now.
Oh yeah.
Yep. It's the Windows 7 kickoff. Windows 10.
I've noticed the icon has popped up on the studio computer and my Asus laptop, so you can pretty much get in line and get registered for your upgrade. Which is free for, I think, everybody but enterprise customers. Now, I wonder, is that popping up for Windows 7 users as well?
From what I understand, yes.
Okay, I do have a laptop here that has 7, so I'm going to have to pop that up, make sure it's updated, and see if we get that as well. And which is interesting, because it's not... I have a weird serial number problem, because it rubbed off the bottom of the laptop, so I don't know if it will do the process. I'm kind of curious. So, because I'm getting the notification, the this is not legalized version of Windows, when it is, it just, I couldn't put XP on it first to register it, right, as an upgrade. So I'm kind of dancing a line there, I guess, officially-ish. But anyways, you know, it'll be interesting to see if I could actually get Windows 10 on that poor old Gateway laptop. But anyways, So, anything else going on? Dutters, anything going on with you? At K Dutters on the Twitters?
No, I'm very bored.
You're very boring.
Right, at least right now. It's nice. I'm catching up on house stuff. It's so amazing.
I have no idea what that's like.
I did yard work, and I did stuff around the house. I actually have a living room now.
Nice.
It was a bunch of boxes and a couch that was in the exact middle of the living room.
I swear I've never officially moved in and unpacked everything from 8 years ago when we got here. As you can see around you.
But yeah, but I've taken a little digital vacation.
That's good.
I don't even know if anybody's even noticed, but I've barely touched social media lately.
That's good. I've noticed nice. Less cat posts.
Yeah, there's nothing. I've posted nothing. It's been nice.
That was my Saturday. I sat and watched Netflix all day.
Oh my gosh, I have a good Netflix story later. I'll just tell you.
Okay.
Later.
I had a rat hole of watching all the B-level Disney movies, mm-hmm. like just whatever was suggested on Netflix. Rescuers Down Under, Great Mouse Detective. I had a day. Then we watched Supernatural. But that's a different podcast. Chilla, what do you think going on?
No, I'm counting down the days till next Tuesday when we can see some WWDC coverage.
Oh, yeah. You can check out everything. We're kicking on. I'm going to try to kick the stream going about 6:30 p.m. We had a lot of just kind of talking about stuff and all the hardware things I'm kind of doing around here for the podcasting. We did Periscope before that, and some people jumped in. What's up, 8-Bit Villain from Periscope, if you checked out the podcast, as you said you were going to. What's up? I've been having a lot of fun with that, and now that all of our buddies on Android are on both Meerkat and Periscope, and it's just been let loose, we can have so much more fun with that, more people popping up and conversing with us. So, but you can check us out at live.awesomecast.net, and you can stick around for the rest of the night. The stream also carries Boss Battle from InsertCoinToBegin.com and our couple of shows from WrestlingMayhemShow.com. We have a couple big guests this week and next week. Some may be on your TV set when you're looking at the, on the Saturday afternoon there on whatever channel carries Friends. But anyways, you can also follow everything at awesomecast.net, awesomecast on the Twitter, Facebook, and Google+, as well as the Facebook group. A lot of conversation going on there. It's usually where the conversation's popping up. Awesomecast@sorgatronmedia.com. If you have any stories, thoughts, anything else you would like to share with us, subscribe to us on iTunes, YouTube, Spreaker, iHeartRadio, and never ever Stitcher. You can find all the links over at awesomecast.net for those. If there's anything missing where we should be, let us know and we'll try to get there. We actually have some very exciting things I'm hoping to announce soon. Not this show, but some of our shows may be popping up on some new platforms that are rising up. No, not Spotify. We don't have the money to get a Libsyn account yet. But if you get on Patreon, hey, we have a Patreon. I'm so bad about this. We have a Patreon account, patreon.com/awesomecast. I'm going to try to look at it and maybe reformat things a little bit. What would you guys want as perks? I don't know what it's more obvious for our wrestling fans. What can I give you? What can we do for you, the tech people here on this show? I'm going to hug you on the webcam if you're on the video here. Let us know on the social medias what do we need to do for you to support us on there, and you can be our boss and have a state of the show, all kinds of stuff like we're doing over on the Wrestling Mayhem show. We have some people have been supporting us with their hard-earned money for a while now, and it's really, really, really appreciated. I'm gonna do a Google Hangout pizza party, and we'll just deliver pizza to wherever everybody is. At some point, that's what we'll do. Well, at a certain point, we will send you a slice on Broadway.
As long as you're in the greater.
No. But at the higher level, we will send you a slice on Broadway, no matter where you are in the contiguous United States. We'll work on that. That'll be our beta testing for next year for Alphalab when we're on demo day. You all have an NDA. Thank you to our awesome chat room joining us all night long, including Wheels, Juggalo, John. Hey, John was saying, every time I hear things about robots, it's like that factory you talked about, and I just think about this, and it's just like humans need not appliance, a video of all the machines putting cars together and stuff like that. So thank you for that in the chat room. Thank you, Wheels, for sticking around. and thank you to our awesome chat room. You've been our awesome audience. Thank you to my awesome co-hosts. Have an awesome week. We're getting awesome. We're getting awesome. Yeah, that's what I say. This show is a member of the Sorgatron Media Podcast Network. Find out more at sorgatronmedia.com.